I'm speaking with Ryan Bean. He is a member of the forestry and wildlife team with Clemson Extension. And Ryan, you are going to talk to us today about prescribed burns, which are, and they, burns happened naturally long before man got involved, in, at least in the Southeast, if I'm not mistaken.
Absolutely correct. Before we were here, wildfires would have burned across the landscape freely. They wouldn't be the wildfires you and I picture, though. It'd have been nice, calm, you know, moving fires. Of course, they'd flare up depending on the vegetation type and all, but they would have been, you know, meandering and leave large patches unburned even, and just the landscape would have been completely different. But yeah, fire was definitely here before us.
And since we talked about wildlife being in your title, that was critical for wildlife because it lets more sunlight come in, as I understand it. And then you get a whole different group of plants responding that are very important for pollinators. And pollinators, then it just keeps moving up the food web. Is that some of the reason that these fires are so important?
Yeah, absolutely. And one of the easiest species to discuss when you start talking about fire is the bobwhite quail. If you don't have fire, it's going to be really hard to get bobwhite quail. For the exact same reason you just described, they could care less if there's a tree in sight. And so this idea that there has to be this open forest to encourage bobwhite is just kind of a myth. But what you're looking for is that shrubby layer to come in underneath, and that those shrubs and those herbs and herbaceous plants that are coming in, they're what attract those insects you're talking about. And that's what our small ground nesting birds are looking for.
And then pollinators as well. I mean, it's critical for them. And we know that we have a lot of native pollinators, flies, bees, and things like that. And so that helps them in this time that they seem to be suffering so from habitat loss and other reasons as well.
Correct. Yeah. And without the fire, you're just not resetting that time clock of the plants and regenerating what, you know, these wildlife species are looking for.
Well, how come the trees don't get all burned up? And do some trees that you don't want get burned up?
They do, yeah. Our plants, you know, in most cases have natural adaptations to deal with their surroundings, their environment. And so pine trees especially have a very insulating bark. And so that's what they've used their natural adaptation to survive fires, as compared to something like a red maple or some sweet gum. You know, yeah, some of the sweet gum, depending on where they're at, they'll have a little bit thicker bark. But for the most part, our hardwood trees are more susceptible to fire. And so if we had an area that was prone to fire and had fire on a regular basis, it would have more than likely been dominated by pine trees. Whereas now, when we've excluded fire for so long in a lot of areas, we're getting more sweet gum and woody plants that would have naturally been eliminated or excluded by fire.
And you said that sometimes y'all will find areas that should have been burned, and because the owner might have been in failing health for a number of years or various transfers of the title, you have to go in and not necessarily ideal conditions and make adjustments for that as well.
Yeah, so there's a lot of land transfers happening these days. You know, people that have held land for a number of years and generations even, and just the generations have changed, and the people are just not wanting to hold on to it that might have thought they might have held on to it throughout the families. But through those transfers, you know, it takes time, you know, for people to pass on, for people to change hands, and for people to kind of realize what they've got or if they're going to hold on to it. So, like you said, it does take time. And what happens during that time frame is the fuels build up and we end up in a situation where it could be a more difficult fire to control. The other thing that's playing against us, I'm sure we'll talk about here a little bit more, is just the weather patterns are holding us back too.
Mm-hmm. And so today I think we're going to talk about a situation that was not, you did not expect, because with prescribed burns, y'all do a great deal of research before and getting permission before you set that fire.
Yeah, sure. When we look at a site that we're considering burning, we're looking at the overstory plants, the understory plants, the fuel types, the fuel loading, how much fuel is actually there that could burn, what the conditions are in neighboring stands that could pose a risk if our fire was to escape, what our smoke-sensitive areas are. And that's probably the most important thing for us to consider, is where is our smoke going to go? What is it going to impact when it does get there? And how can we mitigate those problems?
Yes.
And so, yeah, we're taking a look at all of these things. And like you mentioned, the law does require us to notify the fire departments locally to us, as well as getting a burn notification number through the State Forestry Commission.
At the Sandhill wreck, there's been a huge encroachment of residential and some commercial property. And the latest fire that y'all were involved in that did not end up quite as you wanted it to was in that area. So let's talk about how large an area you were trying to burn, what you thought the fuel load might have been, and what eventually happened, please, Ryan.
Yeah, so typically when we're burning them in woods and setting up for prescribed burn, on average, I'd say our fuel loading is somewhere around 4 to 6 tons per acre when I write a burn plan. And that's in a stand that's been managed through timber harvest or prior burn history or whatever it may have been. 4 to 6 tons is a good average for a managed stand. But in this particular area we were burning, and it was only about an acre. So it really was a very small block, really between, you know, just looking at it and our past history, you know, we would have expected this to take, you know, 30 minutes to an hour at most.
Really?
Get it in there because we already had our fire breaks like you're supposed to. We had already had everything in place, our equipment. We had enough personnel. And we show up, and it should have been a nice, quick burn.
Uh-huh.
The fire just kind of meandered around out in there for us. And I can back up a little bit. The fuel loading in this area was somewhere closer to like 14 tons per acre.
Whoa.
So that's a huge number, a huge difference when you start looking at things. And but we had the conditions that we wanted. We wanted to just skim off the top, because one of the things that we run into is when you have that high buildup of organic matter in those fuels, we end up getting encroachment of the root systems up into that. And so we wanted to just skim off the top so we didn't burn up all of our roots that are up in there and damage or cause mortality in our trees.
So in this case, you weren't trying to remove the whole 14 tons. You just wanted to start reducing it and over time get it back to where it would have been the right amount. Is that correct?
That's correct. Yeah, because, you know, putting fire back in there, our goal with this stand and with the stands on Sandhill Wreck is to get them back into a manageable state where we can do things more regularly without as much concern without the depth of concern that we've got right now because of the state that they're in. But it also opens it up to, you know, various wildlife management practices, encouraging different habitats, different species composition. And so that's where we're working towards. So you're right. We just wanted to skim off that top layer and then maybe come back in another year and do it again, and keep working it and whittling it away.
So y'all did, everything looked like it was a good to go. And then why did you think it ended up, because as I understand, it ended up just kind of smoldering. So there was some quick fire. And then was it just like a campfire might be the all overnight just kind of putting out smoke?
Yeah, great example, Amanda. That works out really well because it's just exactly like that. We lit our fire. It burned. It took a little longer than expected. Our wind wasn't kind of as strong as we had hoped. So we were looking more like 4 to 6 miles an hour of wind in the stand, and it really was more like 1 to 2. And so the fire just kind of meandered around on us. And plus, there's a good bit of scrub oak in the stand, and so the hardwood leaves kind of slowed things down too, whereas if it was just strictly pine straw, it typically is a little bit faster moving, a little bit fire.
Yeah.
If you have zero wind, you light a match, it's just going to expand at its own rate as it can preheat the fuels in advance of the flame and cause them to combust. And that would take forever. And obviously we have narrow windows and time frames we have to get the fire done in because of the smoke management guidelines that are in place and that kind of thing. And so most times we try to start somewhere around 10 or 11 o'clock in the morning once the dew is lifted, humidity is starting to stabilize. And we try to be done by 3 or 4 o'clock in the afternoon.
Huh?
And so, of course, we're just doing 1 acre this time. But again, the situation we're in, the location we're in, we try to just get things done as quickly as we can to provide more of a buffer on the backside to, you know, clean things up. And so we did that. And then everything looked good. We mopped up a few hot spots, which just means we went out and put some water on some stump holes and maybe a snag that had some rot resin on it that was burning up the side of the bark.
Yeah.
But then we started getting calls later that week that there was still smoke.
Oh.
And, come to find out that, you know, just our humidity had stayed pretty low. And we saw these things coming, but we didn't see it staying for as long as it did. the weather forecast just didn't look that way when we made our initial assessment, made our plan, and lit the fire. But turns out it did stay low, and so that meant that the duff layer that was left behind after we burned across the most recent fuels that had dropped or the litter, it continued to burn into that duff layer and consume the more dead stuff underneath. And it just, there's no real active flame when that happens. It's just the heat is contained within that litter layer, and it just continues to smolder along. And a lot of times what you'll see is the litter around the base of the tree is what's consumed. And really that's typically because as the bark sloughs off the outside of a tree and it falls down, it lands in such a way that there's more oxygen around it.
Y'all stayed on top of it. Wasn't like you just said, oh, this is just what happened.
Yeah, and see, Sandhill Wrecks, somewhere around 500 some acres, I believe. And so it's a big piece of property, but it's not huge. And the people that work there are constantly, checking the property out, making sure everything's all right. And especially since the public's out there, you've got to keep a constant eye on things and make sure, everything's working as it should and everybody's okay. But yeah, just checking in on it and then getting the few calls we did, and the fire department had shown up a time or two, I believe. Just to come back and check on things as a result of the calls they were getting. But yeah, we definitely stayed on top of it and kept putting water out as necessary.
If people have questions about prescribed burns and the things that y'all do, do y'all take calls from the public?
I work in Kershaw County as my home office, and I've got 5 counties here in the PD, but I'm more than willing to travel the state if I need to or help whoever I can. With our position with Extension, we're here to just provide science-based information and unbiased information, and just help provide the best information to better the lives of our clients. So if I can help somebody understand fire and how it might apply to their land a little better, I'd be more than happy to help them. And they can feel free to reach out to me, and my email is rbean@clemson.edu.
All right. Ryan, thank you so much for sharing this information with us. And we may want to check with you as the summer progresses and find out how things are going moving forward.
Okay. Thank you, Amanda.